They bled us white, the bastards. They take everything we had. And not just from us, from our fathers, and from our fathers' fathers.
And from our fathers' fathers' fathers.
Yeah.
And from our fathers' 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 fathers.
You're right, Stan, don't labour the point. And what have they ever given us in return?
The aqueduct.
What?
The aqueduct.
Oh, yeah, yeah, they did give us that. That's true, yeah.
And the sanitation.
Oh, yeah, the sanitation, Reg. Remember what the city used to be like?
Yeah, all right, I'll grant you, the aqueduct and sanitation are two things the Romans have done.
And the roads.
Well, yeah, obviously the roads. I mean, the roads go without saying, don't they? But apart from the sanitation, the aqueduct and the roads...
Irrigation.
Medicine.
Education. Yeah, yeah, all right, fair enough.
And the wine.
Yeah, yeah, that's something we've really missed, Reg, if the Romans left.
Public baths.
And it's safe to walk in the streets at night now, Reg.
Yeah, they certainly know how to keep order. Let's face it, the only ones who could in a place like this.
All right, but apart from the sanitation, the medicine, education, wine, public order, irrigation, roads, a fresh water system and public health, what have the Romans ever done for us?
Brought peace.
Alex D. Tocqueville, in his book American Institutions and Their Influence, stated, quote, "In that land, the great experiment was to be made by civilized man, of the attempt to construct society upon a new basis. During the 18th century, the experiment deepened, as Americans began to contemplate that they could form the first democratic nation in modern times. Americans adapted and invented forms of government fit for the scope of their needs. Their inexperience and the intense expectations for their future led many to seek the wisdom of past generations. As they designed their new experiment, only one true republic could give a blueprint. Rome became their teacher. No other republican nation or state can give a more in-depth portrayal of the human conditions, as its rise and fall gives a glimpse of a state that with strength overcame and controlled the ancient world, only to lose its power and eventually fall." Meyer Reinhold states, quote, "The founding fathers ransacked the ancient world as a usable past for guidelines, parallels, analogies to search for solutions to their political problems. The Roman Republic lasted from the overthrow of the Roman Kingdom, traditionally dated from 509 BC to 27 BC, with the establishment of the Empire, which some argue lasted until 1453 AD, a state that existed in many forms for two millennia. It was not just Rome's government that influenced our nation, but its laws, art, architecture, language, and culture. We will begin to explore the impact of Roman influences on the United States, and in the end ask, what didn't Rome do for us?
George Washington knew that many people compared him with Cincinnatus, and he liked that, and he consciously worked to encourage that image. And so, for instance, during the darkest periods of the war, when some thought maybe he should resign, he held off that resignation because he wanted to do like Cincinnatus did, wait until the enemy was defeated, and then in a big show lay down his power, which he did, and he retired to his own plow at Mount Vernon.
Cincinnatus, a Roman general, lived in the 5th century BC. He is remembered for his resolve, modesty, and lack of personal ambition in a world where ambition created kings. He becomes a model of civic virtue for both the Romans and the Americans. He was content with working his 3 acres of land in retirement, but was asked by the Roman Senate to leave his plow in the field and replace it with his armor and sword to again save Rome from its enemies. The Senate declared him dictator, a position of absolute power, but once the threats to Rome had been dealt with, Cincinnatus stepped down. He resigned after holding office for only 15 days. even though he originally accepted it for a period of 6 months.
And in such an emergency situation as this, the Roman Constitution called for the appointment of a dictator, somebody who would be elected by the people, but then once elected, would have absolute power, life and death power over all citizens, but only for a maximum of 6 months. Now, he could have stayed on and he could have used his power as he wished, but the very day that he returned to the city, we're told, he immediately resigned the office of dictator, walked back to his farm outside the city, and continued to plow his farm. And the Romans loved to tell that story because here was a man who was totally selfless, who cared nothing for his own livelihood, for his own life, but merely to serve, wished to serve.
It is no accident that one of the most famous sculptures in American history is that of George Washington depicted as Cincinnatus. It was created by the French neoclassical sculptor Jean Houdon. The sculpture was commissioned in 1786 and finished in 1796, and due to the mold taken of Washington's face, is the most accurate illustration of our first president in existence. In his right hand is a cane, his left arm rests on the fasces, on which is slung his cape and sword, and at the back is his plow. There are other artists that follow this tradition as well. In 1783, before Washington was elected president, Charles Wilson Peale's victory arch depicted Washington as Cincinnatus. No existing pictures remain, but this triumphal arch, comprising paintings done on oiled canvas and suspended over a large wooden frame, was a temporary construction meant to mark the recently established peace between Britain and the new United States. The arch was finished in Philadelphia on December 8, 1783, with the following lines: "So he who Rome's proud legion swayed returned and sought his native shade." The arch allowed spectators to pass between its illuminated columns. Unfortunately for Peale, his construction was not made of sturdy Roman concrete, but was built with very combustible varnish and oil, and was illuminated with over 1,000 candles. It actually caught fire, injuring observers and attendants, causing mass public chaos. It burnt Peale so severely that he was forced to remain in bed for over 3 weeks. The construction of the triumphal arch dates back to the early Roman Republic. These structures were to dedicate and commemorate victorious generals or significant public events such as the founding of new colonies, the construction of a road or bridge, the death of a member of the imperial family, or the ascension of a new emperor. Triumphal arches can be seen throughout America, from Georgia to New York City. Most of these arches were influenced by the Arch of Titus, constructed in the 1st century AD. Washington was not the only founding father that sought inspiration through the Romans. Early colonial and American education immersed every child in the classics. What the students read in grammar schools were virtually mandated by admission requirements of the colleges, and these remained solidly classical from the beginning of our nation through the 18th century, and was virtually unchanged for close to two centuries. John Adams once wrote to his son, quote, "In company with Sallust, Cicero, Tacitus, and Livy, you will learn wisdom and virtue. You will see them represented with all the charms which language and imagination can exhibit. You will witness vice and folly painted in all their deformity and horror. You will remember that the end of study is to make you a good man and a useful citizen. This will be the sum total of the advice of your affectionate father, John Adams." Thomas Jefferson was also deeply inspired by the Roman Republic. He believed in an agrarian republic whose principal power lie with the farmer soldier citizens. In 1800, about 90% of the American public was engaged in some form of agriculture. Mayor Reinhold states, "An agricultural base for the republic with the availability of freehold land was deemed by most of the founding fathers to be a prime safeguard for liberty and stability. The virtuous farmer, the purity and simplicity of his life, were widely invoked, a model conjured up from a classical past simpler than the English and French present. Thomas Jefferson, along with writing the Declaration of Independence and being our third president, also found time to produce some of America's most profound architecture. Neoclassical and Palladianism influenced his design. Palladianism stemmed from the Venetian architect Andrea Palladio, living in the 16th century, who was in turn influenced by the Roman architect Vitruvius. Vitruvius was rediscovered during the Renaissance and lived in the 1st century AD. He was a Roman author, architect, and civil engineer. He is best known for his multi-volume work entitled De Architectura, known to us as the 10 Books on Architecture. The work is one of the most important sources of modern knowledge of Roman building methods, as well as planning and design of structures, both large and small. Vitruvius is famous for asserting in his books that a structure must exhibit the three qualities of firmatas, utilitas, and venustas. That is, it must be solid, useful, and beautiful. Jefferson was not a trained architect, but studied classical architecture as it is shown throughout all his projects. Jefferson designed his home in Monticello, his retreat, Poplar Forest, the Nelson County Courthouse, and helped design his most useful public structure, the University of Virginia. Jefferson was very passionate about education and the establishment of public education. He was very proud of his work founding and designing the University of Virginia. The one characteristic which stands out with Jefferson's architecture is the use of the octagon and the octagonal forms in his designs. The rotunda at the University of Virginia was the main library, which was inspired by the Roman Pantheon, this structure being built in the 2nd century AD during the reign of Hadrian. The Pantheon was built over 2,000 years ago, but still has the largest unreinforced concrete dome in the world. Jefferson was also instrumental in helping to design the Virginia State House in 1788.
Even after a century of glass and steel, when we think of public buildings, we still think of columns and porticos. The very first temple-form political building in America, or indeed the modern world, was the new State House in Richmond, Virginia, designed by Jefferson in 1785. Jefferson was totally enraptured by an ancient Roman temple he visited in Nîmes, the Maison Carrée, or Square House. "Here I am, Madame," he wrote to a friend in Paris, "gazing whole hours at the Maison Carrée like a lover at his mistress." He had a stucco model made of it and shipped it back to Richmond, and he bullied the legislature into accepting it as the basis of the new design.
As the United States' global presence has increased, many critics of America have labeled us the new Roman Empire, expanding and influencing global politics just as the Romans did. But it is not the empire that influenced our founding fathers. It was the structure and strength of the Republic. Reinhold states, quote, "Above all, Americans turned to the Republican model. The appeal of the Roman Republic to Americans lay in its pluralistic culture, its durability, flexibility in policy, balanced constitution, agricultural economy, religious toleration, and its Roman virtues, especially patriotism, self-sacrifice, and frugality."
To the founders, the past was not something that was dead, it was something that was alive, especially the Roman past. It was alive with personal and social meaning. This was crucial, I think, to the American Revolution because they were doing something really unprecedented in this revolution, and yet they were able to feel that they were not the first. The basis of our political system, I think, lies in Rome.
Even the etymology of the word republic is Latin for res publica, loosely translated as the public thing or affair. For better or worse, we are not a true democracy. The United States is a federalist constitutional republic. The fathers did not adopt a form of popular democracy like that of Athens, but took the republic